Okay, so many of us have been doing church, well, differently. Sunday mornings have become a bit more casual. Living rooms and coffee shops have become sanctuaries. And fellowship has a new, less personal touch. It hasn't been easy. Yet, here we are, gathering, worshiping, learning, being the church. Now more than ever, we're reminded of a simple truth. The church is not a building. It's the body of Christ. It isn't built with brick and mortar, but with faith and hope. In the midst of uncertainty, our calling remains the same: to share the truth of the gospel with a world God loves. Throughout history, the church has prospered in difficult times, and today is no different. We are still the church. We're just doing things a bit differently.
We sing. Sing this with us.
I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Buried with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good. When you make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. Cause you are good. So I'll praise your name as long as I'm breathing. Cause you are good. Yeah, I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Buried with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good. If you make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. You are good. So I'll praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good. Never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found.
me. Oh my God, so good. Never give up, never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love, because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good. Never give up, never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love, because of your love for me.
Consume me, consume me.
still call out my name. When my flesh is weak, will you help me see? You are all that I need. You are all that I need.
What's up? Welcome to the church at Lake Forest Online. My name is Chris Sykes. I get to be one of the pastors here at the church. And if you have never connected with us before, we would love for you to take your phone and text the word guest to 662-709-6849. When you text the word guest to that number at the bottom of your screen, you will get a response with a link. We'd love to be able to connect with you. We'd love to be able to, you know, send you a text about our church, maybe send you an email. And we'd love to invite you to come join us in person at 10 a.m. As a matter of fact, this morning we are meeting in person at the church at Lake Forest right now as you're watching this streaming live online. But I'm actually, we're changing our strategy just a little bit starting this week. So I'm actually kicking off a new series in person this morning called Life in Six Words that you will see the first week of next Sunday morning when you join us, if you join us online. So check out that preview right here. It is. So I'm excited to kick off 2021 with this new series, Life in Six Words, that you will see starting next week. Make sure that you join us online. And again, if you can, come join us in person at 10 a.m. This week, what you are seeing online is our last week of the series that I've entitled Throwback. We've gone back and we've chosen a few, actually three, of our favorite messages throughout the course of 2020. And this is the last one. I think it's very fitting for this week with the turmoil that we've seen in our capital. This week's message comes from week three of our series called Under God, where I preached, obviously from a scriptural standpoint, but I used the Pledge of Allegiance, a few of the phrases of the Pledge of Allegiance, kind of a springboard. So one nation under God, indivisible with liberty and justice for all. And so this week's message is from week three of Under God called Indivisible. Indivisible. You guys check that out.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
Hey, what is up, Church at Lake Forest? Welcome to week three of our current series, Under God. Under God. We're in the middle of an election season, and by my best count, as of today, Sunday, August the 27th, I'm sorry, September, I can't even get that right, September the 27th, 2020, we have 37 days until the election happens on November the 3rd. Now, many of you probably know that we have what's called the Electoral College, but you may not really know how that whole process works. So I want to geek out for just a minute, you know, and I want to make sure that we have an educated electorate. So just, you know, bear with me for just a second. But the Electoral College is constitutionally mandated. It's also been modified by the 12th and the 23rd Amendments. It consists of 538 members. So here's where those, and they're called the electors. Here's where the electors come from. They come from our state congressional districts, however many senators and congressmen in the House of Representatives each state has. That's how many electors that state has. And also the Washington, D.C., because it's not a state, right? It doesn't, the land does not reside in any state. It also gets some representation because obviously it wouldn't be fair for people to live there and work there and not be represented in their government. So they get three electors. But the other states, we all get electors based on our senators and our House of Representatives, the same number. And each state elects their electors based on what the states have decided. And so what happens in almost all states now is we go to the polls and we vote, and based on who wins the election in our state, we live in the state of Mississippi, I do, and many of you watching online live in the state of Mississippi. So depending on what our state has decided, how we vote in our popular vote, then a certain slate of electors are selected based on our vote. But it's the electors themselves who actually select the next president. Now, there's a lot of history to this. There's a lot of, I think there's a lot of confusion as well. There's also been differences over the course of the years. For instance, back in the 1800s, state legislatures actually chose the electors. The public didn't go to the polls and vote, and that vote choose the electors. actually the state legislature did that. The people voted for the legislature, and the legislature chose the electors, and then the electors chose the president. I know that may seem confusing, and there's lots of pros and cons, and I'm not going to get into all that this morning. I just want you to understand the way that it works. And so what will happen is we'll go on November the 3rd, and we will vote. December the 8th is the deadline for any election disputes to be resolved. So many of you who were alive back in 2000 will remember the hanging chads in Florida, right? And there were lawsuits. This year, there will likely be several lawsuits in different states. Some will be filed by the Republican side. Some will be filed by the Democratic side. And there will be some lawsuits. All of those are supposed to be settled by December the 8th. Now, what happened in 2020 is that the Bush v. Gore and Florida and all that actually went past the deadline. So it's not, it is a deadline, but sometimes it can vary a little bit. Sometimes the Supreme Court, as happened then, has to step in and actually resolve something and make a decision. But December 8th is when all those election disputes are supposed to be resolved. And so then the state declares, here's how the election went in our state, right? And so these are going to be the electors who will represent our state. So then in this election, on December the 14th, 2021, our electors will meet, right? So they're all going to meet. The electors from each state, they will meet, and then they will place their ballots. They will actually vote. And so what happens when they vote is the official copy of the ballots, there are multiple copies of the ballots. One copy of the ballots are sent to the president of the Senate. Now, in case you don't know who that is, that's the vice president of the United States of America. The vice president is always the president of the Senate, because the Senate always has an even number of senators. And so in case of a tie, the vice president serves as the president of the Senate, and he always casts the tie-breaking vote. So anyway, the ballots go to the president. That will be, or to the vice, to the president of the Senate, which is the vice president of the U.S. That's the official copy, and they'll be counted, right? So they've still got to be counted. They'll be counted later. Another copy goes to the Secretary of State for all the states. A copy goes to the National Archives and Records Administration, and it also goes to the presiding judge in the district where the electors actually meet. And those serve as that, and that one serves as a backup copy in case the original copy is somehow lost or destroyed or there's confusion or whatever, right? So we've got multiple copies as backups, but the official copy goes to the president of the Senate. Now, what happens on January 6th is that those ballots will actually be counted, and the president will officially be declared on that day, right? Now, I know you can remember from elections past that, you know, the different presidents are declared winners, and the loser concedes, okay? And there's been a lot of talk this year about whether or not if either side loses, will they concede? There have been several articles that I've read this week about, you know, if Donald Trump loses the election, will he concede? Will the military have to be sent in to remove him? Will he use the military to be able to stay in office? There's lots of debate about that. And I'm just going to go ahead and warn you now, from November 3rd to the first week of January, all sides are going to point fingers, and they're going to claim one thing or another. There's going to be lawsuit after lawsuit after lawsuit. But the reality is, in every single election, until the electors' votes are counted, and by the way, it's Congress that counts them. They come together, both houses of Congress, the Senate and the House of Representatives, they come together and they count them, and then they, you know, declare the actual winner. Until that happens, I'm just going to suggest that neither side concede, because there's no reason to concede. Until that is official, nothing should happen. Now, it happens every year. There are often defeats and concessions made, but quite frankly, it doesn't have to, because it's not official yet. So I'm just saying that to say, just beware on both sides, whether you're Republican or Democrat. It doesn't matter who wins and who loses. It's not official until January. And then, of course, on January the 20th is when we inaugurate our next president. Now, no booing, no cheering for whoever that may be and whoever your candidate of choice is. But it could be Joe Biden. It could be Donald Trump. Either way, we are still a church. Jesus is still in charge, right? No matter who wins or loses, no matter who holds office, our God still holds the world. Our God still holds the world. So here's what's going to happen. It'll probably start in November. It'll definitely kind of peak on January the 20th at Inauguration Day. But what will happen, as soon as it becomes clear who the winner is and who the loser is, and this is going to happen in homes across America, but it's definitely going to happen in churches to Christian people, or in their homes, but to churched people, to people who say they're Christians, there's going to be a wide array of emotions, but many are going to say, "Thank you, God. God answered our prayers, and this person has become the president of the United States of America. Thank you, God." And there's also going to be probably an equal number of people who are going to be shocked, right? They're going to be in shock and dismay and wonder, how could any Jesus follower ever vote for this buffoon who is now our president? There's going to be all kinds of emotions on both sides. How could they possibly vote for this man or his party and what his party stands for? But you got to remember that God is still in control, regardless. And so what I want to talk to you about this week is the word indivisible that's in the pledge. So if you'll remember, we're talking about one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And so in week one, we talked about being one nation. It's this idea that if you are a Jesus follower, this nation is not your home, that you are a foreign ambassador sent here by God to be a representative, to share the wonderful message of reconciliation that your King has sent you into this world to send. And so we are a holy nation, a royal priesthood set apart for a holy purpose. And we can't forget what that holy purpose is just because we're in the middle of an election season. Then last week in week two, we talked about under God. And I answered the question, how do we live under God in a culture that is increasingly divisive, increasingly hostile to our faith? I want to recommend you go back and you watch that video. And let me just say this, keep watching online. I record this prior to preaching on Sunday, and I'm just going to tell you, there's something about being in the room, right? I really wish I had a recorded video of the message Sunday to save, and I didn't because I pre-recorded this. But man, last week in person, from a worship perspective, and I believe from a message perspective, you just needed to kind of be in the room. So man, I just encourage you, when you feel healthy enough and when you feel like the world is healthy enough to rejoin church, don't stay home just because you can watch on video. It is healthy for us to come together as believers. So please do that. So then this week we're talking about indivisible, which goes along with please come back together. And then finally next week, I'm going to talk about this question. How do we as Jesus followers with liberty and justice and grace and truth follow God in a post-Christian nation? Now, I know some of you may immediately think we're not a post-Christian nation because we were never a Christian nation. I disagree with that, and that's okay. We're going to talk a little bit about it next week. So how do we live with liberty and justice, grace and truth in a post-Christian nation? We'll talk about that next week. So this week is indivisible. Indivisible. We as believers, regardless of our political persuasion, need to remain indivisible. This is a deep value in our church, in the church. And the reason that it is a deep value for me personally and for our church is because it's a deep value for Jesus. This is something that Jesus talked about. This is something that Jesus taught about. He taught about being unified. And as a matter of fact, Jesus He was a massively faithful man of prayer, right? Jesus, 100% God, also 100% man. He prayed to the Father regularly. His habit was to go to the synagogue every week and to teach and to worship. And his habit was also to pray regularly. And we're taught to pray without ceasing. Now, as a massively faithful man of prayer, very few of Jesus' prayers are actually recorded in the Bible. But we do have a few of them. In John chapter 17, if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and turn to John 17. We're going to start there this week. John 17 records one of those prayers. In fact, it's probably the lengthiest prayer that is recorded for us in the Gospels. For instance, John 17:17 says, "Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." Jesus was praying for his followers and for us to believe the truth, that the truth of the word of God, as well as the word made flesh, Jesus himself, he is the truth. That the way that we are sanctified, the way that we are made holy, is through that truth, through believing that truth. And in John 17:20, he goes on to say this, "I pray also for those who believe in me." Now, who are those? Who are those who believe in me, who will believe in me? I pray for those who will believe in me. That's us. Jesus is praying for his future followers. I pray for those who will believe in me. Jesus is praying, man, 2,000 years ago, Jesus prayed for you. He prayed for your kids. He prayed for your wife, for your husband, for your parents, for your grandparents who trusted in him. Jesus prayed for your grandkids who aren't even here yet. Jesus prayed for you. If you are a believer, if you're a Jesus follower, this prayer is for you. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message. There is the disciples, right? Through their message. Verse 21, that all of them may be one. That all of them may be one. Jesus is praying for his future church, that all of us would be unified, that we would be one. Verse 23 says, so that, why am I praying that they be one? So that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. How is the world going to understand that Jesus was sent into the world with love for the world? How are they going to know that? How are they going to understand that? Through the unity of the church, through us being one, not fighting, not arguing, but loving each other and loving the world and showing the world the love of Jesus. Sadly, so many Christians are more divided than they are united. There are lots of reasons that we might be divided versus being united. Listen, I know that many people criticize our church, criticize the church at Lake Forest for the, you know, the music that we play, the way that we do church. People criticize other churches. It just seems like Christians, and this is criticism coming from other churches, from other Christians. It doesn't bother me. The criticism doesn't bother me. What bothers me is the fact that we as Christians criticize each other. I'm afraid that people in our church might criticize the other churches down the road. I've sat at lunch with pastors of other churches and leaders of those pastors, leaders among those pastors, who have asked me directly questions about some other church down the street and criticized those churches because of the style of their worship. You know, we as Christians will say, well, you know, that church, it's just a bunch of video preachers. How could you possibly be a church if all you do is you go and you watch a video? Hello, what are we doing right now? Like, video has saved the church in 2020 with the coronavirus pandemic. You know, so people will criticize that. They'll say, well, it's just a feel-good church. It's all about making you feel good. So you want church to make you feel bad? They'll complain about rock music, right? Or the style of music, or it's too boring. They still play an organ, or they don't play any instruments at all. I can't believe they do that. Have you seen how they baptize people? They've got this big pool. They have no pool. They only sprinkle. They only splash. They shouldn't wear a hat in church. I cannot believe that worship leader has a hat on. Not only does he have a hat, he's got tattoos. Doesn't he know he should cover those things up? I can't believe that church would allow somebody on stage with a tattoo. The service is too long. The preacher preaches too long. Preacher preaches too short. It's not long enough, right? His messages are too shallow. His messages are too deep, right? It's too funny. It's too dry. This church building has no stained glass. Every church should have stained glass. I can't believe that that church spent so much money on their stained glass, right? There's so much money involved in that. This church is too missional. This church is not missional enough. There's so many things that we could criticize and that we often criticize about other churches, and we got to stop doing that. And let's just be clear, right now in this season, that's not what we're arguing about. That's not what is dividing us right now in election season. We need to recognize that what's dividing us are things, are issues like abortion, sexuality, race, and racial issues, and to a lesser extent, issues like immigration and health care, maybe even taxes, are dividing Christians, right? We're divided over this. And listen, we can have differences of opinion, but we can't let that divide us. We cannot point our fingers and say, you're not a Christian because you don't agree with me politically, or you're not a Christian, or you can't be a church if you don't agree with us in style. Okay? The church down the street is not our enemy. Another denomination is not our enemy. Many people may not even realize that the church at Lake Forest is a Southern Baptist church. That is the kind of church that we are. But that is not what's most important about our church. What's most important about our church is that we want to see people come to Jesus Christ. That's what's most important, not what denomination we are. And we shouldn't be pointing our fingers at the church down the street or at some other denomination. They are not our enemy. They don't hate God because they're different from us. And those Christians who vote differently, who may vote for another party or may vote for another president or may vote for another issue on a ballot, they are not your enemy either. And I'm going to say something here that might be very controversial, but I still believe that it's true. Even those people who may worship a different God are not the enemy. Let that sink in for just a second. Jesus came into the world to seek and to save those who were lost. Everyone worships another God until they trust Jesus as their Savior. Even if they say they worship God, if they've never trusted Jesus, they're worshiping some other God because Jesus is God. They're not your enemy. We have an enemy. He is a spiritual enemy, not a physical enemy. The church is not, another church is not an enemy. Another Christian is not the enemy. Another faith system is not the enemy. We have an enemy, and in the Hebrew, the Bible calls him Hasatan. Hasatan. In other words, the Satan. Satan is our enemy. Satan is our enemy. We're not in a boxing ring, in a fighting match, in a wrestling match, where we're in one corner, you know, we're the Baptist church in one corner, and there's a Presbyterian church in the other corner. Or we're a Republican church in one corner, and there's a Democratic Christian in another corner, and we're fighting against each other. No, we're all Christians in the same corner. We're wearing different tights, and we got on different, you know, paint on our face, right? But we're all fighting against the enemy that's in the other corner. And our coach is Jesus. And the referee is God, but Satan is in the other corner, and that's who we're fighting against. We're not fighting against another church, we're not fighting against another religion, and we're not fighting against another political party. We're fighting against Satan. Sin and Satan are our enemies. Why does Satan want to divide us? Because when we are divided, we are weak. When we are divided, we're fighting against each other, and we're fighting his battle for him. We're fighting each other for Satan, and he is beating us because we are not unified. When we are unified, we are unstoppable. But if we're arguing against ourselves, if we're fighting amongst ourselves, we're not moving forward. We're standing still, right? We've stopped the forward march, bringing the kingdom into the world. We've stopped the forward march against the gates of hell, and instead we're just arguing with each other. If anything, we're going backwards instead of going forwards. We must be united. And Jesus prayed for unity. He said, make them one, make them one. Why? So that the world will know about his love. The way that the world is going to understand the love of God is through the unity of the church, that we're unified in sharing the gospel. So we must unite. I want to make three quick points for you this morning. Hopefully they'll be quick. And that is this. Number one, why should we unite? Number one, we desperately need each other. We desperately need each other. Listen, we cannot significantly impact the world alone. What's my evidence for this? Listen, we can barely impact our families alone. We can barely impact, even if we can't impact our families, we can barely impact our neighborhood alone. Like just the houses on our street. I mean, let's be clear, let's be honest. How many of you have stepped out of your house, you've met all your neighbors, you know all their names that live on your street, you've invited them to church and they come to church with you, or you've heard their faith story, you know where their faith resides, and you know that every Sunday morning they get up and they go to their respective churches. They don't have to come to church with us, but right, or Saturday night or whenever it is that they go. Do you know that about all your neighbors? I'll just be honest, I don't. I know it about some of them. I've had those conversations with some of them, but not all of them. We need each other to impact the world. There's going to be some people that you can impact that I can't, and vice versa. We desperately need each other. Romans 12:5 teaches us this about the church. Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. That's Romans 12:4-5. Just as our bodies have many parts. Listen, this is a picture, right? That the church is the body of Christ. And so like a body, we all have different parts. We all have different functions. It would be really weird for me to stand before you to share this message with you this morning without a mouth. Right? I couldn't do it if I didn't have a mouth. It'd be really weird for me to go up on stage Sunday morning when I share this message live with a mouth, but with no feet, with no legs. It'd be very difficult for me to do that. I could. Maybe somebody could help me, there are plenty of people who have that issue with them. They're in a wheelchair, they use their hands to walk or whatever. But it would be more difficult to do that, right? It would be weird for me to maybe have a mouth and hands and feet, but get up on stage and not have a brain. That's what the message would be like, right? Some of you are probably thinking he's brainless anyway. And what if I had a mouth and I had hands and feet, but I had a brain, but I had no heart to pump blood? Then I would be dead, right? There's no point in going any further if I don't have a heart, because I could not possibly be alive. Listen, you are part of the body of Christ, and your part is important. The part that you play in the body of Christ, the body needs you, and you need the rest of the body. The part that you play is important, and it's important for you to be to play your part, to do your role inside of the church. We're not all the same for a reason, and that's a good thing. But if you are just going to church, if you're just going to church, you're just watching online, you're just coming in person, and you're just sitting there, not doing anything with the gifts that God has given you, then that part of the body is not functioning in the role that God has ordained for it to function in. And God's body wants to use your part to make a difference in the world, and that's not happening. If all you're doing is just sitting and soaking, then there's something that God wants to do. He wants to use you as part of the body to accomplish that's not being accomplished because your part is not participating in the body of Christ. So we've got to be careful. We've got to make sure that our part is doing, that we are all doing our part. We desperately need each other to reach the world. Unity, that Jesus prayed for is not uniformity. We're all going to have different functions. We're all going to have different parts. There is strength that comes in our diversity, whether it's diversity of socioeconomic levels, whether it's diversity in race and skin color, whether it's diversity in background, and whether it's political diversity. That is okay. But we need each other, and we can find strength. Listen, I want my wife to be a part of the decisions that I make, even though, you know, I believe firmly that the Bible teaches that God, you know, that Jesus is the head of the church and that the man is the head of his family. And that's not a slight to a single mom household, because she has to carry that role. She has to play the role of the mom and the dad. And that's a heavy burden. And I salute single moms. I adore single moms, because they're carrying a weight that they were not designed to carry. And they do it with such grace and with such strength. But God designed the man to be the head of the household. But that doesn't mean that I lord it over the household. No, there's strength in diversity. There's strength in our home, because my wife is a part of the decision-making process. She brings such wisdom. She comes to our staff meetings, even though she's not on our staff. Not always, but she's there regularly, because we have them in our home a lot of the times. And she wants to be there. And I often turn to her and ask her, what is her opinion? You know, my staff probably gets tired of me sometimes asking what her opinion is. But it's because I so value her views. And sometimes they're different than mine, but sometimes they bring a lot of strength. Often, they bring a lot of strength to our decision-making process. So listen, just as different Christians accomplish different things, so do different churches, right? Sometimes, you know, you might say, I don't like that TV preacher, right? He's just, you know, name it and claim it or whatever. But listen, how many people has that TV preacher introduced to Jesus? How many hundreds of thousands and maybe even millions of people have tuned in on any time, they've tuned in online and they've watched a preacher and they've heard a clear gospel presentation. And in that moment, the Holy Spirit has used that TV preacher to save someone's soul. And maybe they even continue watching for a while, but what happens in most cases is eventually they find a local church home. That TV preacher that you may not like is serving a purpose in the body. As long as he's preaching salvation through faith in Christ Jesus alone, I'm on his team and he's on my team, and he has a part to play in the body of Christ. Maybe another church's primary role, not their only role, but maybe their primary function in the greater body of Christ as a church is to finance missions, right? Is to be a wealthy church that sends money and sends people all across the world, maybe even sends people to smaller churches like ours, or churches even smaller than ours, and churches that don't have the finances even that we have to get started. And maybe that's a church's primary role is to develop an amazing children's ministry curriculum that's used by churches all around the world. That happens often. We can't hate on a church because it's a little bit different than ours. We cannot be Baptist first. We cannot be Methodist first, Lutherans, Charismatics first. And we also can't be Republican Christians or Democrat Christians. We can't be Republicans or Democrats first. No, we need each other. We need to be unified. And so we are Jesus followers first. Above everything else, we are Jesus followers first. Our style of doing church is not God's favorite, right? It's not like God, you know, 100 years ago said, man, I really do love me some good old, you know, piano and organ led hymn music. And now in 2020, man, I'm really kind of getting tired of that hymn and piano and organ music. And I really think that my favorite music is stuff that comes out of Elevation or wherever, you know, it's led by a rock and roll band. That's not God in heaven. His favorite is not your favorite. Here's God's favorite style of worship. It's a heartbeat that matches his heartbeat 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's his favorite worship style. And God's favorites in politics are not the Democrats or the Republicans. They're not some other country's rule. God's favorite is a theocracy. It's when God is in charge because we've given him our hearts. We will not vote for who leads in heaven. It's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That's it, period. So let's stop. I mean, we can still have some political debates, but let's stop the bickering and the arguing. We need each other, and we are Jesus followers first. When Jesus gave us the Great Commission, he said, to go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I'm with you always, even until the end of the age, right? Jesus is with us. He told us the where we go into the world. He told us the what. It's the gospel. We're sharing the gospel. We're baptizing people. But he didn't give us the how. I mean, yes, he told us to preach and to baptize, or to teach and to baptize, but he didn't give us all the methods. He didn't say, well, you should use a PowerPoint presentation, or use video, or, you know, it's, man, video's bad. No. Jesus didn't give those kinds of examples for how. We use all kinds of different methods, but we all share one message. Jesus loves you. We are all sinners in need of a Savior. Jesus died on the cross to save us from our sins, to do what we could not do, to pay the penalty for our sins with his death, and then to raise again and defeat death, hell, and the grave, to come back to life on the third day, because he was and still is God. God the Son, seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us right now, today. We cannot reach everyone by ourselves. We need other people, and they need us. Number two, to remain united. Number two, we err on the side of being for and not against. As Christians, as a church, we should err on the side of being for and not against. In other words, let's be known for what we're for. I've preached this before. Let's be known for what we're for and not known primarily for what we're against. If I'm going to make a mistake about another Christian, if I'm going to make a mistake about another church and the way that I'm sort of judging them, I want to believe the best and not assume the worst. I want to believe the best and not assume the worst. Build your ministry on what you're for. We are going to build our ministry on what we're for, not what we're against. So at the church at Lake Forest, we say we are for our neighbors and the next generation. We're for our neighbors and the next generation, seeing their lives changed by Jesus and his word. But that's who we're for. We're not against some other church. We're not against some other faith. We're not against some other political party or any particular political party. We're for our neighbors and the next generation. And when we say that, what we don't have to say, and this is what bugs me so much about other pastors and other churches, and I know I'm not against other churches, but here's what bugs me when I hear it. And I hear Christians sitting in the pews say this. Well, we're not like the other church down the street's full of smoke and mirrors, right? We're not like that fellowship church down the street that's all full of smoke and mirrors. We're for our neighbors and the next generation. We're not like that legalistic independent Baptist church down the street that makes you dress a certain way and sing certain songs. No, we're for our neighbors in the next generation. Or we're not like that watered down cult of a multi-site church. You have some kind of affinity groups, whatever that is. They do cooking classes and they have motorcycle clubs, whatever. We're a real deep church because we're for our neighbors in the next generation. Listen, you can drop all the other junk and just be for our neighbors in the next generation. Why do we have to drag our other churches through the mud? Why do we have to be against so many things? Now listen, I'm not saying that we won't call sin, sin, but style points or even political debates does not mean that something that you don't agree with is sinful or is harmful to the body of Christ. Yes, those things do happen, and yes, we should certainly call them out. But in general, that's not what we're doing. We're just being against something that's different from us. So we got to be careful with that. Listen, some preachers won't tell you this, but we're for our neighbors and our neighboring churches down the street. When they win, when the churches down the street are growing and they're winning people, they're bringing them to Christ, their numbers are growing, they're baptizing, and they are winning, we should celebrate them, not worry about whether or not our people are going to go to their church. If somebody does leave our church to go to some other church, that is okay. We will love them, we will pray for them, and we'll celebrate that church got an amazing family that wants to follow God and follow his leading and hopefully follow the head of their household, the dad, the husband, and they're going to another church to plug in there to be part of the body, to get off the pew and into the trenches and to serve God. That's what we're going to celebrate. And listen, if the church at Lake Forest ever becomes a dying or even a dead church, please go somewhere else. Go to the church down the street that's living and thriving, because that's where I'm going to be with my family, right? Be a part of a church that's growing and thriving, and we will celebrate those churches that are doing that. And the church at Lake Forest is growing and thriving, and we're going to celebrate, but we're also going to celebrate the victories of the churches down the street. So when an argument comes up online about church, you don't have to post something negative. When an argument comes up online that's got a religious or even a political bent to it that you don't agree with, you don't have to fight back. What you should be contributing is love and kindness. I'm not saying never post, you know, a comment that's an opposing viewpoint, but the way that you present yourself and frankly, whether or not you even insert yourself into a conversation should be determined from the viewpoint of unity, of love, and kindness. I've had to remind myself of this lately. I've not inserted myself for a couple of weeks, and that's not normally my habit, but quite frankly, a few weeks ago, there were a couple of conversations that I inserted myself in, and there's one in particular that really bugs me because, and it was with another brother who is a pastor, this was not a political conversation whatsoever. It was a strictly religious conversation. And I said some things that I wish I had said differently. I jabbed a little bit. I was trying to be iron that sharpens iron, but I said a couple of things that quite frankly, I probably jabbed. It was too harsh and it ended up being unkind. My goal in all of it was to bring unity to the church. But I think I did cross over, and I've apologized to him for doing that. But what we have to be careful of is to show love and kindness and to show unity. We don't have to fight back with every conversation that we see on social media or even every conversation that happens in an office. There are lots of things that are said in my office that I may overhear, that I may not agree with, but I don't just, you know, stick my head around the corner and say, hey, that you're wrong about that, right? But that's not my role and my goal all the time. My role and my goal in my office is to let the ladies that I work with, because they're all ladies in the office, know that I love them, that I'm praying for them, that I care about them and their children and their families, and that I'm here to support them if they need that, right? And to invite them to church and invite them into a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. I asked my staff Wednesday night, what is the goal of the church at Lake Forest? What is our goal as a church? And there was about 6 seconds of silence. And I think a couple people started to speak at one time. And if I'm not mistaken, it was Robbie who actually said it, but he said something like this: to see lost people saved. Yes, that is the goal of our church. That is the goal of us as Christians. That is always our goal, to grow the kingdom, to advance the gospel. And when we say or do things that keep that from happening, then we're actually going backwards in advancing the kingdom. But here's the other thing. How does us bashing another church, bashing another political party, sharing any kind of political view and fighting adamantly for that political view, I mean, in reality, how does any of that help us advance the kingdom, advance the gospel? I believe that most of the time, there are a few occasions that it does, but most of the time it does nothing to help us advance the gospel. In fact, in many cases, it actually detracts from the love of God, detracts from the gospel. It causes disunity in the church. We need to be all about Jesus and His Word, being for our neighbors in the next generation, sharing the gospel, pushing forward. A well-known evangelist in the 1800s, his name was D.L. Moody, Dwight Moody, right? D.L. Moody, he said this: you may find hundreds of fault finders among professed Christians, but all their criticism will not lead one solitary soul to Christ. Let me put it in my words in 2020. You will never hate someone into heaven. You will never hate someone into heaven. You can hate them into hell, but you won't hate them into heaven. It's through the love of Jesus Christ and us sharing the gospel with them that people come to faith in Christ. So unity is important. Let's be indivisible. Finally, number three, we love like Jesus loved, right? We're going to love people into heaven because we love like Jesus loved. Jesus said, love your enemies. He said, don't hate those who persecute you. Love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. He said that, listen, if somebody asks for the shirt off your back, man, give them your shirt and give them your coat too, right? Give them your jacket. Give them all the layers. They need it more than you do. God's going to bless you. He's going to meet your needs. You'll get another shirt. You'll get another jacket if that's what you need, right? We should have the kind of love that Jesus had. In John 13, verses 34 and 35, Jesus is meeting with his disciples, and this is right before he's arrested and crucified, right? And what he says to his disciples is this, a new command I give you. Listen, you've got all these hundreds of other commands to follow, and like, oh, Jesus, I thought we were past this. Jesus says, I'm going to add one more to it. Matter of fact, it's going to replace all those, because if you do this one, you'll be doing all those. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. I want to make sure that you understand this. This is not the golden rule. This isn't do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's love one another like you love yourself. That's what they had been living under. That's what most of us live under. Love others as you would love yourself. That's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus says, love others like I have loved you. Love each other. Love the world like I loved you, like I gave myself up for you. Verse 35, by this, if you love the world like I've loved you, by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. In other words, people will recognize that we are followers of Christ. They'll recognize that there's something different about us if we love like Jesus loved. We want a perfect theology, right? We want just the right style of worship. We want to have just the right political post on Facebook, and we'll deride those who we think are wrong when we are right. But here's what's interesting about this passage and other passages like it. Jesus didn't say to always be right. Jesus said to always be loving. Because let me let you in on a dirty little secret that most people won't admit to you. You won't always be right. You will not always be right. But you can always be loving. And you can always be one with your brothers and sisters in Christ. Yeah, I had a friend in high school. We worked together, and we would introduce each other to new people, to our friends or whatever, and, you know, with our names, and we would, regardless of who was doing the introduction, one of us would say, and we did this a lot of times, one of us would say something like this, and I'm always right and he's never wrong, and when we disagree, all hell breaks loose, right? And you know, we would joke about it, and the reality was, yes, sometimes we disagreed and we would debate that, but at the end we knew we were brothers. We were brothers in Christ. We loved each other. We hugged each other. You know, we remained friends throughout high school. But we both had very strong personalities, and we could not always both be right because we didn't always both agree on everything. And so what Jesus is saying is, listen, you may disagree, but you can always be loving. This is what is going to grab the attention of the world around us, is that we can love each other even when we disagree. I mean, think about it. What's tearing our country apart right now? What's tearing our country apart right now is not love, it's hate. It's not loving someone of a certain color or loving someone of a certain political bent, a certain political persuasion. It's not loving someone because of their faith. That's not what's tearing our world apart right now, our country apart. What's tearing at the fabric of our nation right now is people who say, we have a difference and we hate those on the other side. And it goes on both sides, that we're hating whoever is on the other side. What will grab the world's attention, what will set us apart as a church, is that even when we disagree, we still love. And Jesus said, love each other as I have loved you. I gave myself up for you. Jesus gave up his rights as God. Jesus gave up his dignity as God. He gave up his dignity as a human being and became ultimately humble to death and he was stripped and beaten and nailed to a tree because he loved us more than politics. He loved us more than he hated the fact that we were sinners. Jesus loved us. So for just a moment, let's practice indivisibility. Let's practice who we are as Christians. Let me tell you a little bit about my Savior Jesus. And let this be what unifies us. Let this be the points that we unify around. My Jesus, the Jesus that we worship, is the Son of the living God, born without sin. He came into this world full of grace and truth, full of love and mercy, to seek those who were lost and to save sinners. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He is the Lord of glory. He is the great I am, the one who was and is to come. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He's the soon returning King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the Word made flesh. He is the anointed, chosen Son of the Most High God. He is the Good Shepherd. He is the living vine. He is the bread of life. He is my refuge, my shield, and my righteousness. He is the defender of the weak, the father of the fatherless. He is my advocate sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for me and for you, for us right now. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through Him. He guards and He guides. He hears and He heals. He forgives and He frees. He is the great abolitionist. He opens blind eyes. He raises the dead. He delivers the captives and He defends the weak. He loves what religion rejected, and His love never fails. There's nothing you can do to cause Him to love you more, and there's nothing that you can do to cause Him to love you less. My Jesus is the one that Satan could not stop. Death could not hold Him. The grave could not defeat Him. It could not contain Him. He is risen from the dead, and whoever calls on Him would be saved, forgiven, transformed, and made new. This is our Jesus. This is the one who loved us, who gave His life for us. Can we agree? Can we unify that Jesus is the Son of God and that this is the message of reconciliation that He called us as ambassadors to carry out into the rest of the world? Jesus saves. If you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, today is the day to do that. And if you have, today is the day to champion that call, that cry. Jesus saves. Let us not be known for what we are against. Let us be known for who we are for. We are for Jesus. We are for His Word. We are for our neighbors. We are for the next generation. The world is sick. The world is sick. I could stop right there. But the world is sick about hearing about the love of Jesus. It needs to see the love of Jesus, and it will only see it through you and through me. We don't have time for tribes. We don't have time for Twitter fights. We don't have time for Facebook wars. Our mission is too important, and our time is too short. Whether you vote for the right or you vote for the left, let your love be right down the middle, and let it reflect our Savior, Jesus Christ. If we disagree some politically, our mission unites us spiritually. Let's not forget that. Life is not about us. We reflect Jesus, His glory, and His values. Jesus prayed for us. So what if we, indivisible, are the answer? Let me pray for you this morning. Dear Heavenly Father God, we love You. God, I love this church, and thank you for all those who are joining us in person and who are watching online. God, I thank you for the Church Universal, for your body that is gathered all around the world right now. Some have already gathered, and some are going to gather later today, but God, this weekend, we are coming together to worship you, to praise you, to learn from your word, and God, we're going to go out into the world, and we will represent you. So God, help us remember this week to be all about your love, to be indivisible, even when we disagree with each other, that we will still love and hug and respect and be kind. We will show the world your love because we are one heart. We don't always have to be right, but we will always be loving. God, remind us of that this week. Lead us, guide us, keep us. Jesus, we love you. Listen, if there's anyone watching this morning and you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, and you would say today that you understand that you can feel something going on in your heart. There's an urge, there's a yearning, and maybe you don't even completely understand everything. You don't have all the answers. That's okay. I don't have all the answers either. But you feel this piercing in your soul, and you understand that this morning you are a sinner. That there are things that you have done to disrespect God and to go against His commands. And you may not even be able to name all of those things, but you know that you are a sinner who needs a Savior. And you hope that God would save you. Listen, Jesus is the hope of the world. God sent His Son Jesus into the world because the world was broken by sin. Jesus came into the world for you. The Bible says that God loved the world so much that He sent His Son Jesus into the world that whoever believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. God loved us so much that He gave us His Son. And when we believe in Him, we receive His salvation, we receive His forgiveness, and we are accepting His love. So this morning, if you've never done that, Jesus says, the Bible teaches us that if we believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord, that we're making Him the boss of our lives, that we know that He lived and died and rose again to save us from our sins, then we will be saved. And so if that's you this morning, if the desire of your heart is to trust Jesus as your Savior, I just want to invite you right now out loud with your family, or if you're at work and you need to do this silently, that's okay too. But after the fact, man, tell somebody, leave us a comment, send me a message, send a text to that number, right? But regardless, right now, make this your prayer. Pray this with me, wherever you are. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, thank you for loving me. I realize that I am a sinner. I'm not perfect. And God, I know that you expect perfection. And so you sent Jesus to save me. Jesus, thank you for dying for me. Jesus, I believe that you rose again to save me from my sins. And so, Jesus, I accept your love and I ask for your forgiveness. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. Save me. And I will live for you because you died and rose again for me. It's in Jesus' name we pray this prayer. Amen. Listen, if you prayed that prayer this morning, welcome to the family of God. Welcome to the body of Christ. You are my brother or my sister in Christ. Jesus now calls you one of His children. You are a child of God. So welcome to the family. Let us know about it. Drop us a comment. Send us a message on Facebook. Text us a message to 662-709-6849. We'd love to hear from you and talk with you about your next steps wherever you are in the world, wherever you are in the nation. If you're watching from somewhere else, we'll help you connect with another local church that's close to you. We've got contacts around the world that we can connect you with. We love you, church family. I love you. Thank you for joining in this week. Thank you for being a part of this series. Be indivisible this week. Let us show the world that we're followers of Christ because of the way that we love one another. Don't forget that. And just like we say every single week, no matter who is president, no matter what party is in charge, God is still King. I love you. Thank you for joining us. Y'all have a great week. I'll see you next Sunday. Bye.